Hi again, everybody. Welcome to Inside Golf. I'm Harry Donahue. A little weather update. Sooner or later, that snow back there will be gone. I promise. I also promise a great show coming up here today on Inside Golf. We'll be talking more about getting to know the Golf Association of Philadelphia. Marty Emino of GAP will be here with Robert Morey. He's the president of the Golf Association of Philadelphia. He's from Marion, and we'll talk about some big plans that they have for the upcoming golf season. Hey, do you go online to buy your golf equipment? And maybe sometimes you think the deal is too good to be true? It may be. There's a Philadelphia-based company that looks into counterfeiting when it comes to golf equipment. And we'll talk with the company's Jason Rocker all about that growing problem. And we'll have our usual teed-off panel coming up next right here on Inside Golf.
Inside Golf, now celebrating its 20th season, is presented by Destination Monco Golf. 54 courses, 300,000 yards. Check them out at MoncoGolf.com. By the First Tee of Philadelphia. The First Tee helps young men and women become better golfers, but most important, better people. Get involved. Visit thefirsttphiladelphia.org. By the Golf Association of Philadelphia, GAP, celebrating amateur golf since 1897. By Jersey Man Magazine, it's a Jersey way of life. And by Philly Man Magazine, bringing it to Broad Street. And by Inside Golf's partner since 1998, the Philadelphia Section PGA, experts in the game and business of golf. Take time to thank your local PGA golf professional.
Along with being stewards of the game of golf, your local PGA professional wears many hats.
We are teachers.
We are players.
We are managers.
We are merchandisers.
And community leaders.
But we all wear one badge.
PGA professionals are well-trained experts who work hard to share the joy of golf with our neighbors for over 90 years. To find your local PGA professional, visit phillypga.com. Brought to you by the Philadelphia section of the PGA.
We are the experts in the game and business of golf.
Success requires hard work. No way around it. Realize timing is key. Be willing to push yourself. Stay in control. Trust technology to support you. My father once said, doesn't matter what you do in life, just be the best at it.
Welcome back to Inside Golf. We continue with our look at the Golf Association of Philadelphia and their plans for 2017. Here's Marty Emino.
Thank you, Harry. We at the Golf Association of Philadelphia are excited to join the Inside Golf family. I am Martin Emino, and in this regular spot, we'll discuss all things GAP. So how did we get to where we are today? An association of 187 member clubs with more than 56,000 members, men and women. Back in October 1896, Devon Golf Club and Philadelphia Cricket Club played an interclub match. And as the story goes, the day was so well enjoyed by everyone involved that they asked how could they bring that feeling to the masses. On February 5th, 1897, seven men from four clubs, the Belmont Golf Association, which is now Aronimink, Marion Cricket Club, which is now Marion Golf, Philadelphia Country Club and Philadelphia Cricket gathered at the Market Street Bank. The Golf Association of Philadelphia was born. It is the oldest regional or state golf association in the country. Only the USGA is older. We're here at Marion Golf Club, the home of GAP President Bob Morey. And Bob, could you just touch on the responsibilities of being the president of an association that's 121 years old?
Well, it's a tremendous responsibility to continue on this association as our forefathers found it, to grow and encourage the game of golf in Philadelphia, its clubs and its members. The executive committee takes it very seriously, everything that we do in trying to preserve those the heritage of the association, from managing the handicap system that from the USGA to all the course ratings for all the clubs that we do, the junior programs, all the tournaments, the 70-plus tournaments that we run every year for all ages, all abilities of golfers. We take these responsibilities very seriously. Another important thing that the GAP board does is strategic planning, thinking ahead how we can improve, constantly improve everything that we do for the game of golf in the Philadelphia area.
The purpose of the association today is the same as it was then, to promote, protect, and preserve the game of golf. That's done through our programs and member services. The organization's two most visible programs are tournaments, including the BMW GAP team matches. Yes, the name has changed, but it is those same matches that date back to the 1800s, and handicap computation.
Well, we're always excited about the GAP team matches starting. That's the start of the golf season. Then this year, we're very excited about the fact that the BMW Philadelphia Amateur will be at the Philadelphia Cricket Club, a founding member of GAP. And then the Open will be at the Philadelphia Country Club, another founding member. We're also very excited this year that we've been asked by the USGA to administer the local qualifying for the United States Women's Mid-Am Tournament. That'll be held in July at Concord Country Club. We're really excited, hoping that a lot of the fine women golfers in the Philadelphia area will try to qualify and will qualify to be able to play in the Mid-Am in October down in Naples, Florida.
In addition to the aforementioned tournament schedule, the association administers course ratings, a junior golf program, and the J. Wood Platt Caddy Scholarship Trust. The scholarship offers young men and women who regularly caddy at GAP member clubs an opportunity to receive a grant for higher education. We've seen some of the greatest amateur golfers in history pass through GAP: J. Wood Platt, William Hyman III, and Jay Siegel. Winning a GAP tournament isn't just about hardware, but rather the company you join. The official start of the Golf Association of Philadelphia season is April 1st. That's when golfers can post their scores. This year, however, we have a bit of a change to the closing of the year. Bob, could you just touch on that for us?
Yeah, normally the golf season ends in the Northeast on October 31st. But this year, we've made a change. The associations in the Northeast got together and discussed it, and with the weather changes the last few years, it was decided that the season would be extended till November 14th. So you have a little more time to play a few more rounds and post a few more scores this year.
Well, no matter the time of the year, you should be posting your score anyway.
Post all your scores.
Well, Bob, on behalf of all golfers in the Delaware Valley, just wanted to thank you and the executive committee for all that you do. So that's GAP in the thumbnail.
Yes.
We look forward to showing you much more throughout the year.
And we'll be following GAP and the GAP events all through the 2017 golf season right here on Inside Golf. Coming up, a look at counterfeiting when it comes to golf equipment. That's next on Inside Golf.
Product is to make sure you're buying from an authorized retailer.
My favorite core value is sportsmanship, integrity and honesty, respect, seeing what they do differently that I do,
courtesy. I like helping people a lot.
Integrity and perseverance are one of the big ones that are my favorite. So.
The first tee of Greater Philadelphia, where golf is more than a game.
Oh no!
What?
Mandy keeps sending me pictures of the girls' shopping trip to Monco.
Why did you tell him you couldn't go again?
Because I told him that we needed to catch up on housework.
Philadelphia PGA is back with our winter segment, working with Rothman Institute to bring you tips to stay fit and healthy and golf ready this offseason. We're here at Philadelphia Country Club with head golf professional Scott Riley and Rothman Institute sports medicine surgeon Dr. Paul Marchetto to take you through some tips and exercises for this offseason.
Thanks, Leela. Back here with the doc, we're going to talk about some exercise that you can be focused on as the weather's cold, which can also help with your pre-round workout and really get you ready for those spring games when you're going to want to be at your peak, really.
At your peak, that's
and,
it.
Doc, maybe walk us through a few of the things that we can be working on.
The things we talk about, Scott, you know, think of during the season, people get there, they're late, jump out of the car, barely two swings, and they're on the tee box. It's really important that we work on some preseason stretching exercises so you get accustomed to it. You don't have to think twice about it. We can do some things that stretch the core, stretch the quads, the abdomen, the waist, really work on these stretches. And we'll go through some exercises that we can demonstrate that are great for the preseason and then during season pregame. Really important to get there and do these before the round.
Are these going to be dynamic or are these more static stretches? Do we want this?
They'll be very dynamic. I think you get on the ground, there's some stretching, the quad stretches, the leans, some of the things we can show you and demonstrate how to perform them quickly so you're accustomed to it, get out pregame and really do them quickly without wasting a lot of time. This one will be the figure four walking. So you stand up on the balls of your feet, lift one foot up, grab the heel to the waist, head straight up, back straight, pull it forward, and then step down and do the next. Here's the knee tuck walking. Stand on the balls of your feet, head and chest upright, lift one knee up, clasp it, pull it to your chest, toe up, foot parallel to the floor, and then repeat to the other side. We'll call this the down and up to really stretch the back. You stand up straight, then your right leg goes forward, your right elbow goes inside your right knee, bend your left knee, lean forward, and repeat that. Make sure you switch up so you do both sides.
Doc, those are some great exercises. Certainly anything that you can do throughout the winter and prior to golf can really lead to some great performance out on the golf course. And I think everyone's going to be well on their way for this spring.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Scott.
Well, you'd probably never imagine how much counterfeit product is out there when it comes to golf. I'm talking about clubs, balls, apparel, whatever. Jason Rocker, you're in the business of, well, being a spokesperson for a group that's out there looking for these counterfeiters.
I am. I represent some of the largest golf manufacturers in the world. Ping, Callaway, Acushnet, TaylorMade, Parsons Extreme Golf. So really, you know, this group came together as a way to fight counterfeits in the golf industry and raise awareness so that consumers don't get duped and buy this fake product.
And like I said, it stretches not just to equipment, but also into the world of apparel, belts, shoes, you name it.
If people are willing to buy the stuff, they're going to make it. You know, essentially, we're dealing with criminals here, right? You know, so at the end of the day, if they think someone's going to buy a shirt or a belt or a golf grip or a club, whatever they can make money on, they will produce.
Right. Okay, you have here an assortment of examples of counterfeit product. Can you show us a couple?
Yeah, so for instance, you know, this is a golf head. It's a club head of a Titleist. And if you look at it from an aesthetic standpoint,
they look like twins.
They do look like twins. But then you turn it around and you look on the inside, and this is actually the real club.
Hollowed out.
It's hollowed out. It's weighted specifically. It's done on a very technical high-end machine, whereas the counterfeit is, it looks aesthetically very good, but you look at it and it's basically, it's a solid piece of iron. It's like a piece of scrap metal.
Right.
So you hit like that and you may as well be hitting with a lead pipe.
Exactly. All right. Another simple counterfeit product, if there is such a thing.
Yep.
Looks like a nice Titleist polo shirt.
That's right. But if you look closely at the logo here, one, it's the stitching is all off.
It's on
the
angle
is off. Right. And you know, you really can't be sure what the dye or anything in that shirt is made of. And you know,
they may try to sell this thing for the same price as the authentic.
Correct. And it goes beyond aesthetic or even price. Some of this stuff is dangerous. You know, so the dye in that shirt may be chemically toxic. You don't know. Some of these golf products, from a club standpoint, the counterfeits, some of them may just be a performance issue, but we've had some where they're really dangerous. Some people hit it, the heads are flying off, the shafts have broken. So that's kind of what we want to make sure that people know. Like, this isn't just a, hey, I'm saving a couple bucks. It actually can be a dangerous issue. And then when you're buying these clubs online, well, this just in, you're putting your credit card information and you're giving it to a criminal.
God knows where that goes. The other thing is there one area of the world where a lot of this counterfeit product is distributed?
So Manufactured, it's about 90% of it is manufactured in China. The
95%.
Yeah, 90% in China. And then it's sold all over the world, usually via the web. So, you know, what we like to tell people is the only way you can be safe and the only way you can guarantee that you're getting the authentic product is to make sure you're buying from an authorized retailer. That doesn't mean you can't buy online, because there are authorized retailers online, but you gotta buy from an authorized retailer.
And your company is called?
So this is a group, it's essentially a consortium. It's the U.S. Golf Manufacturers Anti-Counterfeiting Working Group. It's a big name, but we're solving a big problem, so I guess we needed that to match.
And you have an idea, to put in perspective, the amount of counterfeit clubs that are out there would go from where to where?
So we look at, you know, again, we don't have annual reports because they're criminals we're dealing with, but we estimate that there's a couple million counterfeit clubs made a year, and if you lay them end to end, they would go from Bethpage Black in Long Island, New York, all the way to Pebble Beach in California and back again. So that's kind of a good indication.
That's a lot. And money-wise, we're talking in the millions.
Millions, tens of millions. You know, it's a big problem, but we're making a big impact, and you know, we're hoping that segments like this will help people avoid the problem.
And another thing about Jason, Philly guy.
I am a Philly guy.
Office in Center City.
Right on 15th and Walnut Street. That's right.
Thank you very much. Thanks
Harry.
For the information.
All right, you got it. Thank you.
Thanks to Jason Rocker, and be sure to check out their website to find out more about counterfeiting and golf equipment. There's nothing counterfeit about our teed-off panel. Find out more next, right here on Inside Golf.
And it comes to end it, Marion, except the fact that the greens are so tedious.
Welcome back. Inside Golf continues with our teed-off panel. We're talking Masters Golf on teed-off today. And we're at the beautiful Valley Forge Casino Resort in King of Prussia. Entertain your everything right here at the Valley Forge Casino Resort. Panel today includes Jules Quinones. He is on the executive committee of GAP, that's the Golf Association of Philadelphia, and a very good player at Bluebell Country Club.
Thank you, Harry.
Bob Shepard.
Right?
Bob is a longtime PGA professional in Philadelphia, author of his latest work, The Dormy House.
The Dormy House.
Little short stories.
Short stories, doesn't take you long to read.
The Game of Golf. And the publisher of Philly Man and Jersey Man magazine, former Eagle.
And here it is.
Mr. Ken Dunnick.
Good to be here, Harry. Thank you.
Member of Burlington Country Club.
Yes, sir. Proud to be there.
Glad to have you. Hello, friends. Yes, it's Masters time again, as Jim Nance would say. And we're talking the Masters at Augusta, the first major, guys. Always a lot. That's, for a lot of people, Jules, maybe the kickoff event for the golf season, especially if you live in the Philadelphia area, right?
Absolutely.
Huh? And not fortunate enough like you to go back and forth to Florida all the time.
But no, not at all.
We have the Masters getting ready to tee off, and I'm talking to you and the rest of the panel today about who do you like, who's going to win that first major of 2017.
Well, the odds have changed right now. Spieth is the leader on the odds, but...
Barely.
Dustin Johnson's 8-1. They're really looking strong at him. Also, you got Jason Day at 12-1. Rory McIlroy at 12-1.
A lot of chalk there.
A lot of chalk. But you still have old favorites like Phil, 30-1.
There you go.
You know, so... Yeah.
At age what, 46? Phil Mickelson, is that right?
I'm not sure.
He's up there.
Do they have a number on Tiger? Do they have a number
There's
on
no
him?
Number on Tiger.
No Tiger.
He's not there.
How far they have fallen.
Shep, what is it about the Masters? Like, always on day one, somebody goes out there and puts a number up there.
Right.
Okay, par is 72. Somebody, you know, not a chalk guy like we just heard Jules run down. Somebody like maybe, obviously you have to be a pretty good player to get in there, but you didn't expect to see somebody post a 67. And sometimes, by Saturday, they're not even around.
That's right. They bail out all of a sudden. Yeah.
What happens?
Well, you know what? There's a comparison here to be made. Augusta is, yardage-wise, not a long golf course. It's not one of these backbreakers. And what you don't know about Augusta on TV is the fact that most of the holes are uphill. So if it's a 7,000-yard course, you're playing 7,000 long yards. So... let's make a comparison and talk about Marion. Marion is 6,900, but every hole at Marion's uphill. So whatever you're getting out of your four irons, that's all you're getting. You're not going to get any run, you're not going to get any carry. And that's the difference in the two courses. So they were talking a while back here about Dustin Johnson being so long, it's his advantage. Well, it is at Augusta and at Marion, except the fact that the greens are so tedious. And you have to be so tidy with your short game, and you got to be very aware of what's going on with the breezes and things. And so the two courses, although their yardages aren't extreme, and Augusta is not an extremely long golf course, what is it, 7,400?
74. But the difference is, you've got to remember,
they've tiger-proofed it over the years. Yeah, right. They've taken some trees out, yeah, pushed some trees in. Yeah. But Kenny, you know, Jack Nicklaus won six green jackets.
Yeah.
His game, obviously, along Shep's point, was tailor-made for Augusta National, and in his prime, if he had been playing today in his prime, yeah, he probably still would be.
Listen, there's no question that length is an advantage. I don't care what golf course you're playing at, but at Augusta, you better have the putter working. And Jack Nicklaus, maybe the best clutch putter,
yep,
in the history of golf, certainly arguably the best player ever to have played. I have a vested interest in this because I'll be at the Masters this year. I have tickets for the practice round on Wednesday and the opening round on Thursday. I've never been. I'm very excited about it. And of course, we've mentioned two of the players, Spieth and Johnson, right up at the top. I've got a dark horse. I've been watching this young man for a while. Tony Finau.
Oh boy.
He has everything that you want in a player, and it looks to me like he's ready to break through. And if he can get the putter going, wouldn't be surprised to see him near the top.
Yeah.
The only thing is, I don't know, has he played before at Augusta, or is this his first year?
I'm not sure about
it. You know, I think there's only been, the first winner in 1934. That was obviously a first Masters for him. And I think then the next year, Gene Sarazen won it.
Right.
And that was his first year. He didn't play in the initial Masters. Since then, I don't think anybody won it. And that's the problem with a guy if Finau hasn't played. Course knowledge.
Well, DeChambeau played in it before last year? Because he gave a good account of himself early on. I don't remember him being in the field, but he might have with his
amateur. No, he didn't play before. He got in there as the amateur.
He played very well.
Yeah, he did. Jules?
You know, I'm thinking he hasn't won at the Masters yet, but he might come through with Sergio Garcia.
Yay, there you go.
He's playing really
putter,
well.
Putter, though, man. The putter, the bulky putter.
He's got now. See, to me, he's got that under control.
Well, now he's got to make the money, right?
Well, I don't think money's the issue for Sergio, is it? I don't think so.
No,
he's got...
He's been playing well for Sergio, so, I mean, he's a dark horse.
That'd be a popular winner. I mean, Sergio, is he the best player not to win a major? Well, I think he's in the conversation.
He's been in that category, Shep, for a long time, hasn't he?
And like Nicklaus said, you can't make the greens fast enough. If you want a champion, you got to make fast greens, and that is not subscribed to by most of us. Right. We don't want fast greens to that point, but Nicklaus said that's the whole thing at Augusta. It's not the length or anything. It's the speed of the greens. So
you gave me a name. You gave me Tony Finau.
Right.
That's a stretch.
I'm out there, and if he wins,
Bobby,
I want you to replay this.
Give me one name. One.
I got to go with...
Can't hedge.
Jordan.
Spieth.
Yeah, I got to go with Jordan.
Yep. You get his second.
He looks so cool. Yeah.
All right.
Jules, Mr. Oddsmaker over there.
You know, it's a 25-1 shot would be Justin Thomas.
Justin Thomas got off to a great start this year, but this is not Hawaii. This is...
Yeah, right.
We're playing now
Augusta.
At Augusta National. Magnolia Lane.
Yeah.
Huh? All right, you're on record. We're going to hold you to it. That's it. No changes.
Bob went to chalk, though. That's not fair. He's got an advantage.
All right, thanks, guys, for giving us a little preview of the Masters. We'll be back with more of Inside Golf in a moment.
The Valley Forge Casino Resort is the perfect venue for your next conference or event. With a $6 million guest room renovation, 39 separate meeting rooms, and over 100,000 square feet of flexible banquet and exhibition space, it's the largest full-service hotel and only full-amenity gaming resort in suburban Philadelphia. Located conveniently 30 minutes from downtown Philadelphia and near all major highways, Valley Forge Casino Resort is in the middle of everything. Entertain your everything and visit vfcasino.com for more information.
Along with being stewards of the game of golf, your local PGA professional wears many hats.
We are teachers.
We are players.
We are managers.
We are merchandisers.
And community leaders.
But we all wear one badge.
PGA professionals are well-trained experts who work hard to share the joy of golf with our neighbors for over 90 years. To find your local PGA professional, visit phillypga.com. Brought to you by the Philadelphia section of the PGA.
We are the experts in the game and business of golf.
Well, that's going to do it for this week's edition of Inside Golf. Speaking of which, you know, this month we aired our 1,000th show here on Comcast Sportsnet. And next week, we'll catch up and look back at Inside Golf over the past 20 years. Ed Abrams is going to join us. Ed was the first host of Inside Golf, and we'll have plenty more as we take a little trip down Inside Golf's memory lane. You know, it is the longest continuous show aired here on Philadelphia's Comcast Sportsnet, beginning back in January of 1998. It's a show you will not want to miss. Thanks for joining us. I'm Harry Donahue. See you next week. And remember, no matter how bad it's going for you out there, don't pick up, even in that stuff. And we'll be back next week with more of Inside Golf.
Inside Golf, now celebrating its 20th season, is presented by Destination Monco Golf. 54 courses, 300,000 yards. Check them out at MoncoGolf.com. By the First Tee of Philadelphia. The First Tee helps young men and women become better golfers, but most important, better people. Get involved. Visit thefirsttphiladelphia.org. By the Golf Association of Philadelphia, GAP. Celebrating amateur golf since 1897. By Jersey Man Magazine, it's a Jersey way of life. And by Philly Man Magazine, bringing it to Broad Street. And by Inside Golf's partner since 1998, the Philadelphia Section PGA. Experts in the game and business of golf. Take time to thank your local PGA golf professional.